Macmillan Audio presents Alphabet Juice by Roy Blount Jr. Read for you by the author.
According to scholars of linguistics, the relation between a word and its meaning is arbitrary. In proof, they point to pigs. Steven Pinker, in Words and Rules, observes that pigs go oink oink in English, nuff nuff or something like that in Norwegian, and in Russian, something spelled C-H-R-J-O, C-H-R-J-O. That may look arbitrary, as if it went something like this. English committee member number one. What do we put down for pig noise? Member number two, whose motives are unclear. Let's name it for my Uncle Oink. Member number three. No. We need to capture more of that grunt, grunt. Weary groan arises. Member number four. In Russia, he or she is shouted down. Committee chairman, people, we have to move on. Have you ever tried to spell any of the various sounds that pigs make? It isn't easy. It's damn well worth trying, but eventually you have to settle on something close. Chickens being more articulate, you'll find their noises to be pretty similar the world round. Baby chicks go peep, peep in English, pio, pio in Spanish, and pio, pio spelled differently in Japanese. And I'm not sure Pinker is playing fair with that C-H-R-J-O. It's not Russian letters. How am I supposed to know how Russian people or pigs pronounce it? Fortunately, by Googling, quote, Russian pigs go, I have obtained the input of an online chat person at ask.metafilter.com named Mr. Anonymous, who sounds like he knows what he is talking about. In Russian, pigs go hru hru, H-R-O-O, H-R-O-O. But note that these are rolled R's, and the H is more of a h sound, like when you try to build a loogie. Don't try and pronounce the K, just phlegm up the H, says Mr. Anonymous, and that is not bad. Over the years and around the world, generation building upon generation, people have put much mimetic effort into the spelling of pig utterance. For that matter, the word grunt works for me, and I resent any insinuation that I have been programmed by random convention. Dictionaries, in their grudging way, call the word grunt probably imitative. The word is a distinct refinement or counter-refinement of the Old English grunton or something like that. And although the parallel Greek gry, in comparison, looks less than fully swinish, you can see the resemblance. The French for to grunt is grogne. You know what the French for the growl of a car is? Vroom. That car is running on alphabet juice. So, less obviously, are spice and tang and strength. Do you think the word strength fits its meaning no better than would, say, the word delicacy? And, excuse me, sphincter, which shares a root, incidentally, with the Sphinx. Marshall McLuhan, whom we celebrate for coming up with such memes as the global village and the medium is the message, played fast and loose with the roots of words, according to his biographer, Philip Marchand. McLuhan, quote, pored over etymologies in the Oxford English Dictionary as if they were mystic runes, and irritated colleagues at Cambridge by making up fanciful derivations to support his theories. I prefer a firmer grip on etymology. Quote, the wheel ruts of modern English, as etymonline.com puts it. So, I am not going to think of the mysterious statue, the Sphinx, and say the first part, sph, is soft, face of a woman, and we may think of sphagnum moss. The middle part is retentive sounding, ing, and the X is for unknown. I am going to consult several reliable lexicographical sources and report to you that the original Sphinx, the monster whose riddle Oedipus solved, was named by the Greeks from their verb sphingine, to squeeze, because she strangled her victims. Pronouncing sphincter, or squeeze, constricts the throat. Oddly enough, McLuhan did his Ph.D. dissertation on Thomas Nash, who described a comely maid as, quote, fat and plump, every part of her as a plover. A skin as slick and soft as the back of a swan. It doth me good when I remember her. Like a bird, she tripped on the ground and bare out her belly as majestical as an estridge. I say, oddly enough, because McLuhan, according to Marchand, was never interested in the music of words. In Understanding Media, McLuhan maintained that the phonetic alphabet, quote, in which semantically meaningless letters are used to correspond to semantically meaningless sounds, had alienated people from the body. The ink had hardly dried on that notion when the free speech movement broke out at Berkeley, and pretty soon people were running naked and letting their hair grow wild. Maybe many of them were trying to break away from the alphabet, but I wasn't. To me, letters have always been a robust medium of sublimation. I don't remember what I was like before I learned my ABCs, but for as long as I can remember, I have made them with my fingers and felt them in my bones. Where are we at the moment? We're in the midst of a bunch of letters, and if you're like me, you feel like a pig in mud. What a great word mud is, and muddle, and muffle, and mumble. You know the expression mum's the word. The word mum is a representation of lips pressed together. Since it's not merely a sound, mm, but a word, to say it, we have to move our lips. For the separator, between the mms, we choose that utterly unintellectual, though it's what we say when we're trying to think, vowel sound uh, which thrusts at the heart of push and shove and grunt and love. The great majority of languages start the word for mother with an M sound. The word mammal comes from the mammary gland, which comes from baby talk, mama. To sound like a grown-up, we refine mama into mother. The Romans made it mater, from which matter, and matrix. Our word for the kind of animal we are, and our word for the stuff that everything is made of, and our word for a big cult movie, all derive from baby talk. Linguisticians will concede me onomatopoeia, words like snap, crackle, pop, and so on. But they marginalize these words by throwing up the inconstancy of pig sounds. And then they get on with their theories. Steven Pinker does allow that some people might channel their magical thinking into, quote, sound symbolism, words such as sneer, cantankerous, and mellifluous, that naturally call to mind the things they mean. As it happens, scrutiny of the term symbolic in that sense has led me to find a discrepancy in the greatest lexicographical work in English, the Oxford English Dictionary, which we'll come to later. But I won't dwell on that. I will say that theorizing stands and falls on its examples. Here is Pinker. Quote, sound symbolism, for its part, was no friend of the American woman in the throes of labor, who overheard what struck her as the most beautiful word in the English language and named her newborn daughter meconium, the medical word for fetal excrement. Well, that has the ring of an urban legend, a tendentious one, like Ronald Reagan's mink-coated woman stepping from a limousine to claim her welfare check. If there was a woman who gave her baby girl such a name, she had a highly idiosyncratic ear. Of the 1,000 most common female names, according to the 1990 census, Miriam was the only one ending in M, and it was 285th. Salmonella, maybe, or camphophonique, but meconium, no. This mother, I will stop short of saying that linguisticians conjured her up, consciously or unconsciously, to reinforce their denial of so much evidence of the senses. But I will say that this mother is not, in this respect, a good example. The Japanese, I am told, have two different words for two different kinds of imitative language. Gisaigo, mimic voice language, for instance, the word patsu patsu, for rainfall of medium force, and gitiago, meaning mimic condition language, for instance, pitari, to fit exactly. Neither of those examples may seem intuitive to English speakers, but every language has its deep aesthetic network of sonic correspondences. The very consistency of English is inconsistent. Don't expect remember to be the opposite of dismember or pitch, because its vowel sound is like the first one in sphincter, to betoken a withered peach. But all language, at some level, is body language. Or anyway, all English is body English. It beats me why any writer would want to minimize the connection between high-fiber words like squelch or wobble or sniffle or the flinch and wince family or the udges or prestidigitation and the bodily maneuvers from which they emanate and those they evoke. But I don't claim to be a scientist. Science naturally abhors what it can't universalize. For many years, the dominant theory in the science of linguistics has been Noam Chomsky's, that all human language is made possible by a universal recursive, that is to say, allowing of insertions such as this one, grammar, hardwired in our genes. Now, hardwired objectively refers to metal drawn out into threads. Hard, by the way, has a harder sound than soft. And what a fine word wire is. Thin, wiry, and sonically drawn out, like its French counterpart, phi. The German draht is more broadly evocative of the drawing out. But, okay, chromosomes are threads. Chromosomes are not exactly laid end to end, as I understand them, but never mind. Mental activity is demonstrably electric. But what travels through the wires? What force through the green fuse? Alphabet juice. The quirky but venerable squiggles which through centuries of knockabout breeding and intimate contact with the human body have absorbed the uncanny power to carry the ring of truth. If you handle them right. The fact that I have made a living for 40 years selling combinations of letters on the open market in every medium, print or electronic, except greeting cards, does not entitle me to tell you how to write or talk. I do hope you realize that every time you use disinterested to mean uninterested, an angel dies, and every time you write very unique or we will hire whomever is more qualified, thousands of literate people lose yet another little smidgen of hope. And please, promise me, you will never lose your grip on the subjunctive to the extent that someone did in this sentence from USA Today. Quote, if Ramirez stayed in Cleveland, the Indians may not be 7 victories shy of their first World Series title since 1948. If Ramirez had stayed, I cry aloud, the Indians might not be. Damn, damn, damn. I hope this book will be useful to anyone who wants to write better, including me. I have written some of the clumsiest, most clogged yet vagrant, hobbledehoyish, hitch-slipping sentences ever conceived by the human mind. On the radio, I can sometimes talk spontaneously to tolerable effect with the help of voice tone and adrenaline. But almost nothing that pops into my head flows when I set it down in letters. That's about the 9th time I have written that unremarkable sentence. Fortunately, I enjoy fooling with letters, moving them around, going back over them, over and over, screaming. The terrible thing about writing is also the great thing about it. You can keep on changing it. We say that we perfect diction, wrote Wallace Stevens. We simply grow tired. But it's a good tired. That's an interesting expression, a good tired. Do we adapt any other past participle to such purpose? I'm stumped, but it's a good stumped. The franchise I claim is not prescriptive, but over-the-counter. Quality over-the-counter. People who mistreat English or who, with no doubt the purest intentions, discount Sprachgefühl, are messing with the stuff I trade in. If the ABCs lose their savor, I will be hard-pressed to pass along, not to mention get paid for passing along, such an intimate pleasure as I felt while listening to NPR's Fresh Air not long ago. The country singer Don Walzer, now deceased, was being interviewed by Terry Gross. She asked him about his yodeling. He said he did 2 different yodels, a cowboy yodel and a Swiss yodel. A what? Walzer was a big, hearty Texan who didn't seem like the sort of performer who would get off on mocking sissy airs. Anyway, yodeling very nearly transcends gender. Even if you wanted to, how would you make a yodel sound Nelly? Then I realized, Swiss yodel. When the soft S and the Y as in yummy glide together, They make the sound that for some reason we spell SH, as in, oh, how I wish you would wish I would kiss you. I would be the last person to argue that the sounds of our letters are thoroughly explicable. They are a wonder on the tongue. In the tongue.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.